Hello, my name's Zoe Laughlin and I'm a materials expert and one of the directors of the Institute of Making at King's College London. At the heart of our institute is the most wondrous collection of materials, a materials library that has stuff from NASA, stuff from mines, stuff from my garden shed, but is all about celebrating the ordinary and the extraordinary nature of materials. Materials are around us all the time, they're what makes up the world. And so it's very difficult to, you know, do any subject without encountering materials. It might be arts, it might be design, it might be technologies, it could be music, you know, but the matter, the stuff that makes up the objects that we use is our materials. And it's the use of material science that really is central to some of the most extraordinary feats of engineering today. So what I'm going to do today is show you some of our favourite materials from the collection and reveal how the structures inside those materials give them really wondrous characteristics and properties. So this first material I'm going to show you is a pretty unassuming stick of tin. All metals are made up of crystals. So this tin stick has crystals inside which, when you bend the tin, they slide over each other and they don't move easily. In fact, so uneasily do they move that they make a noise and they grate over each other and you can hear the cry of tin. So here's the sound. That kind of crispy, cracky sound. That's the crystals sliding over each other. And what you get is actually vibrations in the hand. The material, which is bendy and soft, actually feels like glass shattering and splintering. So you can hear the crystals in the tin stick. But actually, in this piece of aluminium, you can see them and you can see just how small they can really be. But actually, we have an example of another material, which is just one whole metallic crystal. That's this, a single crystal jet turbine engine blade. And this whole object is one metallic crystal. And it's made by having the liquid metal in the mould, cooling it here, and then starting to pull it out of the mould. And that makes the crystals grow in this downwards direction. And they grow a bit like Christmas trees with these arms that race forwards and compete with each other to travel through this helix. And actually what happens is, at the end of the helix, only one crystal arm has actually got to this point. It's blocked off the others behind it and it solidifies this whole object. And that enables it to be made from one crystal and have no grain boundaries, no boundaries between those crystals, and therefore have no potential cracks. And be really high performance object that can operate in a jet engine under massive temperatures, massive pressures, and yeah, be pretty much indestructible in that situation. Now this material really is magical. This is aerogel, which is the lightest solid in the world. It's made by NASA for catching stardust. It's basically a silicon foam, so a kind of a glass foam, if you will. But the pores of the foam are nanoscale, teeny tiny pores. And this gives it very specific properties, predominantly this blue colour. So this material is blue for the same reasons that the sky is blue. It's to do to the way in which the light passes through it and it's scattered. So it's not blue because of a pigment and to do with absorption and reflection. This is the way the light passes through it. What they do is they take it up and expose it to the vacuums of space, and all the tiny particles of dust that are flying around get a chance to whack into this material and lodge themselves inside it, and then they can be brought down to Earth and examined. Because it contains so much air, it's a really good insulator. And if I hold this piece in my hand, it's actually warm to the touch. It's incredible. Next up, we have a ceramic, but not just any ceramic, a superconductor. Now this is extraordinary, and something very special happens when you get it very cold. And the best way to get things cold quickly is liquid nitrogen. So I'm trying to cool this ceramic to minus 197 degrees centigrade. So if I take this magnet and I bring it into contact with the ceramic, something extraordinary happens. It levitates. Look at that. Brilliant. I can even push quite hard and it's not going to touch the ceramic. Those lines of magnetic field that previously passed straight through the material are now being repelled just by making it extremely cold. Look at that. It's amazing. It's levitating. Superconductors are so named because when they're at these extremely cold temperatures, they conduct electricity extraordinarily efficiently. And if we were able to make materials that could do that at room temperature, it would revolutionise the electricity industry. Now we're moving on to something completely different. This is a material which almost skirts the boundary between animate and inanimate, living and dead. This is a bioglass scaffold, a material which is made to be an implant into the body, a kind of substitute for bone, but you impregnate it with proteins and stem cells, and when it's in your body, you actually start to grow and eat into it, and it turns into bone. The idea being, if you were to break your wrist and, you know, have a nasty fractures and this kind of thing, you might have had pins and bars put in your arm. But the idea is you can actually cut back to nice clean bone, nice flat ends, and make a piece of this stuff and implant it in that gap. Then you impregnate it with stem cells and protein, close your arm up, and then your body starts to eat this material and grow into it, and it turns into your own bone. So in a couple of years' time, you don't have an implant anymore, you just have your own bone. Composition-wise, this is a kind of glass, reason being that the body doesn't reject glass. It's relatively inert, so it can sit happily inside us. This material has been engineered to have this strange, porous, crater-like structure, so that when the bone starts to grow, it can actually start to grow in three dimensions and burrow its way down inside the material. And in fact, it's designed to no longer exist. It's designed to be impermanent, because in a few years' time, you no longer have this material implanted in your body. You just have your own bone. So I can't tell you what the exact composition of this is, because like many materials in our collection, this is straight from a research lab, and it's either secret or it's not fully known, they haven't published the research, but this is cutting-edge science. Now, this is what they make aircrafts out of. It's basically the walls and the floor, that kind of thing. It's incredibly strong, really, really light, both important properties for materials for aircrafts. And how they do it is essentially by sandwiching this stuff in between this composite material, making it rigid. And this is an aluminium honeycomb. Now, it's actually quite weak this way, but really strong in compression in this direction. And this starts off life like this. And what we've got here is sheets of aluminium which are glued together on these nodes. And then it gets pulled out beyond its elastic limit until it stays rigid in this structure and then can be faced and turned into aircrafts. So this is a great example of the relationships between materials and the shapes you make them into. It's the same material all the way through, but a different shape gives it a different property. So there we have it. There's just a few of the extraordinary materials we have here at the Institute of Making. But what I hope you can take away from this is a sense that these properties are due to the structures inside materials, and the understanding that is what material science is all about.